The shaky throw is Cadillac. He went cruising down the bill.
Did Pritch tell you about the Tim Westwood thing we did?
No. Let's start off with that. Go on.
Right, we ready, yeah? Cool.
We're in it, mate, yeah.
Right. Yeah, there was an Emmy Awards. Myself and Pritch got asked to interview people on the red carpet.
For MTV?
Yeah, for MTV. I'm not exactly sure. I'm sure it was for MTV. Yeah, it was for MTV. And yeah, it was great fun. It was cool. You're meeting all these rockers, like the Gallaghers. You know, it might have been short and brief, but it was still, you know, it was quite mind-blowing.
Yeah, but you're sort of there. You have about 30 seconds to a minute, don't you?
Max. It's just like who you're looking forward to see, like what act are you, what award are you for, this, that, the other. So in the distance, we clock Tim Westwood.
Westwood!
Yeah. So I'm like, Pritch, look who's there. It's Westwood. So Pritch gets his fucking smart idea then, right? So the foam surrounding the microphone, he turns it inside out, puts it back over the microphone, rubs his dick cheese in it, and then he's got it right up in Westwood's face. And I tell you what, I don't think we'll be invited to any of his shows. Not that I'm down the trap and all that shit any of these days.
I'm actually hoping to get Westwood on this podcast, so hopefully you won't hear this.
Well, I think it's a bit late for that.
First question. Do you remember the MTV Awards? Was it the MTV Awards, yeah?
The Enemy Awards?
The Enemy Awards.
Yeah, it was a right cheesy one, that, wasn't it?
Cheers, Pancho. Let's clink glasses.
Cheers.
Here.
Absolutely. Pleasure. It's been a long time coming.
It has been a long time coming. I was saying to you a moment ago, you are the most requested guest in the history of Life in the Stocks. Everybody has been after me for months to get you on the show. I've been after you, and here we are. It's finally happening. So
it is finally happening. I'm sorry for delaying the process, everyone.
No. When it was meant to happen, it was going to happen, and this is it.
Yeah, well, you're down in downtown PT now.
I'm in PT. I want to ask you, first of all, about your upbringing. Were you born and raised in this kind of area? Are we close?
Yes, indeed. I was born in
came
a village.
Into the world.
Yeah, I was actually born in Neath, which is part of the same council as Portalbert, in the 13th of the 3rd, 1979. Yeah, I went
13th to of March.
13th of
my
March.
My birthday's the 11th.
Oh, really?
Pisces. There we go.
Yeah. I was actually 13 on Friday the 13th as well.
There you go.
Yeah. So that's it. That might say a lot. But I went to a Catholic school.
Were your parents very religious, or was that just the school that was the catchment area?
Well, my mum, Susie, she was a Catholic. My dad was an atheist. Well, there's not many atheist schools around, so the best school in the area was St. Joseph Comprehensive, which I went to infants, primary and comprehensive and school for me was great.
Did you get on well in the classroom? Were you a hard worker? Did you mess around?
To be honest, I wouldn't say I was the most academic. I left school with GCSEs, but I was always like really into sports, played rugby, played football to quite a high level. Got a Welsh under 15s cap.
There you go.
School for me was, it was a breeze. It was cool. It wasn't until I was 15 that I stopped growing and everyone else started growing.
So you weren't actually the small kid at school?
I was probably like smaller, but definitely not the smallest.
And then something just stopped.
I think I had pubes before a lot of the kids there.
I can believe that.
Yeah. I probably, like the Neanderthal man.
A mustache, age 14.
Oh, like cyborgs, cyborgs, and going to the local offies at like 14, 15, and managing to purchase enough alcohol to sink a battleship for the rest of the park.
And it was a lot easier getting served back then, wasn't it? Oh, photo ID was not required.
Well, yeah, that's... Well, my mother worked in the reprographics in St. Joseph's. She was, like, reprographics librarian. And I managed to laminate, like, a dodgy ID, if you like.
Yeah, yeah. My friend Josh did the same thing. He had a youth club card.
Yes.
And he just literally wrote on it in biro... helper in brackets 18 and over.
That's pretty
and
much
that worked.
That's pretty much exactly the same thing because it was a youth club card that I doctored. And yeah, going on further on down the line, I've also doctored. Do you remember you used to be able to get the yearly passports from the post office?
We're going back a little bit, but I do, yeah.
Yeah, it is going back a bit. But that that'll lead on to another time when that came in handy. Like, very, very handy.
What, when you need to make a hasty exit? I've heard some stories about you missing quite significant flights as well. To jump forward real quick, the MTV Awards in Miami, which is obviously a huge deal for you guys. You were asked to go over there and present an award. Didn't you miss your flight?
I missed a flight from Dublin to Heathrow. And
how did you miss your flight?
Probably... Just
like I need to ask.
Just hanging out and getting intoxicated the night before and doing what you do in Dublin and probably embracing Dublin a bit too much. But I'm half Irish, so yeah, what can I say?
You were just getting in touch with your roots.
I was going back to my roots. Yeah.
So you didn't make the awards?
Yeah, I did make the awards.
Made them.
Yeah, I ended up flying out a day later than the other boys from Heathrow. MTV had to pay for another flight, reluctantly pay for another flight. And in fact, this was my first ever time to the US. And I've had nothing serious, but I've had some incidents with the police. You know, no violence, you know.
Misdemeanors,
you know.
That prevented you from going out there?
I used to like to smoke salad and stuff, and
the old silly lettuce.
Well, yes. When I was 17, I got caught. When I was 18, I got convicted.
So you were charged as an adult, even
so
though
I was charged as
minor.
An adult. Right. Yes, and so I fly out by myself now, and I've got the EBGBs from Dublin, as you can imagine. Hot and cold. You know, even at that, you know, I think I was 24, like flying out there.
And the hangovers weren't quite as bad then, but you must have taken it to that next level.
Yeah, so. Yeah. I think there was a lot more to it than just alcohol, but we won't go there. But so I'm flying out now. And at that stage in time, you used to be, just fill out the green card.
Yep.
So I'm fucking kind of panicking now. I mean, there's a bit of turbulence, and I'm just like, ah, fuck. So I'm like, air stewardess, can I have another green card, please? So she's like, yeah, no problem. So I finally get that one right now, but put it this way. My four-year-old daughter's handwriting could have been better. How I managed to fit it in the boxes is a fucking mystery to me.
But they let you in.
Right, yeah. Well, this is what I'm about to say now. So I land in Miami, going through like first stage of customs, and I'm only there for 36 hours.
So alarm bells are ringing.
I had no mobile phone. Well, I did. I had this big Motorola thing that would take like 2 weeks to charge up. So I didn't even bother taking it with me. And... yeah, so going through the first stage of customs now, and he's like, he was a Hispanic chap, and he was saying, why are you only here for 36 hours, sir? And I said, look, I'm here to present an award at the Latin, you know, MTV Awards. And so then he turns around and he's like, why are you sweating so much, sir? I said, when I got on the plane in Dublin, it was like -2, bearing in mind it's February time now. I was like, it's my first time in the States. I land in Miami. It's 30 plus degrees and God knows what humidity. Not far off 100, I'm assuming. Because it was, you know, I looked like I was melting, right? So he asked me the same run of questions again. I tell him the same answers. He's like, sir, you're going to have to go to secondary immigration now. I was like, oh, fuck, here we go. there's going to be a plastic fucking glove coming out and God knows what.
Bend down and touch your toes.
Yeah, you know, like that was the fucking, that's what I, you know, the preconception I had. But as it turned out, I got back there and there was a lot of like immigrant looking type people, mainly Hispanics and whatnot. It was like going to do you remember going to like the deli or Tesco's and you take your ticket? I'll never forget. It was number 42.
And you had to wait while.
So I had to wait now. So therefore, my anxiety is going through the roof. And I'm like, holy fuck! I'm just gonna let everyone down now. You know. So anyway, number 42, go up to the counter. Why are you here, sir? I'm like, look, here's my hotel. Here's the point of contact. This is the reason why I'm here. But why are you sweating so much, sir? And I was like, look, I've told, you know, your colleague exactly the same thing. I said, it's my first time in America. The humidity is crazy. It's going through the roof. So he looks at me. And I look at him. And I'm thinking, fuck, I've had it. And he went like that to me. Can you show me the inside of your arm, sir? So I reluctantly show him the inside of my arm.
Well, he's checking for track marks, is he?
So I said, I hope you're not implying what I think you're implying. And he just looks at me, and next thing you know, 30-day stamp, bang. Get out of customs, and I'm there now, and I'm thinking, fuck, I better miss the fucking whatever lift. I literally had about 75 quid on me. But there was this big black dude with Pancho.
It said Pancho on the card.
Said Pancho on the card, like that. I was so fucking stoked, like that, right? We end up across one car park, and I'm like, how far away we parked? I really need a smoke, and I don't want to piss off US Customs anymore. He went, we're parked right by there, sir. I said, what? He said, right by there. And it was a stretch Bentley there. I've fucking never been so hyped in my entire life.
Zero to hero,
just like that.
In the limo, popping the champagne.
Oh, it was literally, and like, because I'd been on the plane and my Todd and stuff, you know, I was like, wind the window down, man. I'd like, tell me about Miami, tell me what's going on. So you give me like a mini little tour, and I was fucking stoked. Ended up in South Beach. I was just like, what the fuck am I doing here?
I've been through similar, nothing quite to that extent, but those extreme highs and lows that you get. So this tour that I was just on with Steel Panther, Paris show was in the Bataclan, which is where that incident happened in November a couple of years ago. Mm. So that was a date of big significance to me. Absolutely. I was friends with the band that were involved, and I just thought, I want to go here and do a really good show. Show was great. Afterwards, we had an after party next door. My friend DJ Mike Rock is a big French DJ. We went back to back, had this great night, went back to the barman of the bar's house afterwards all night, just partying. Yeah, the best night. And then I get the train to Belgium the next day, haven't slept, like shaking, like similar sort of deal, right? Yeah, just feeling awful. Pass out on this train. Thank God I was in a reserved seat up until the station that I was meant to be getting off. Otherwise, I would have carried on sleeping and just woke up God knows where. This guy's tapping me. He's like, you're in my seat. I was like, oh, fuck. Oh, we're here. Oh, so gosh. I get out. I'm in this place called Torhouts in Belgium, just buttfuck nowheresville. I get off the train. The first thing I see is this old guy just pissing in the middle of the road, broad daylight. I was like, okay, I guess I'm here. I get to the venue.
Welcome home.
I get to the venue. I just literally get in my dressing room, take all my clothes off from the night before. I have a shower. Luckily, my dressing room is like a sports room, so there's showers in the actual room. And then I just lie out on the floor and nap for like 2 hours. World of pain all day. And then I finally wake up, get on stage, play to like 3,000 people. Yeah. And it's that similar sort of thing of like zero to hero in the space of a couple of hours. It's a great feeling, isn't it?
That's magnificent, you know, especially like, you know, what tragically happened in Paris that night, you know, and like you said, unfortunately, like those guys were fucking heroes, man. You know, like.
The energy in the room was palpable.
You know, to be able to go there and kick that, and like you said, you're friendly with those. That must have been something.
It was one of the most significant nights of my career.
I can see why. Yeah. Because, you know, it was a total tragedy what happened in that room that night. It was fucked. I remember
reading. You can't imagine it, can you? Being on stage and watching that unfold in front of your eyes.
It's just fucking all, like, I don't want to get all fucking political and stuff, but all these people in the world who think they've got a point to prove, like, let's fucking solve it fucking diplomatically and not fucking persecute fucking people going for a good time and people who are providing a good time, you know?
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, innocent people going to a concert to sing, dance, and have a good time and then don't go home.
Yeah, it's extremely, you know, it's touching, man. It's just fucking very, very bad. But anyway, on a floor, on
let's raise a glass to those people.
Let's raise a glass
to drink
to
their memory.
Absolutely. Yeah, so get to South Beach now, and I bump into the boys in what the Yanks have called an elevator. But it was a lift, and I was like, yo, boys, I was like, let's go and have a fucking beer, get to the bar, and it's fucking, whoa, man, it's quite a few quid, like, I'm like, oh, fucking hell, boys, I need to change some money, but I haven't really got too much money. So they're like that to me, oh, don't worry, we'll club in, we'll lend you some money now.
Weren't they going to allow you to expense everything? No,
this is how naive I was, isn't right. So they're like, out of the goodness of their own heart, giving me my own fucking per diems. So like, I find out about an hour later, and I feel like, oh, Pancho is such a fucking gullible cock sometimes. But I don't know, that's maybe sometimes what you get for being too honest, I don't know. Yeah.
Well, you're obviously thrust into this world as well, and we'll get more into that in a moment's time. I want to backtrack in a bit. But, you know, you're obviously just regular guys. And after the huge success of season one, you're thrust into this world that none of you are prepared for. You don't know anything about. So, assumedly, you're all walking in there very naive, wide-eyed, like, this is fucking great. What's going on? We've been given the golden ticket here.
Yeah, we were just fucking lapping it up and not really thinking too much into the future. It was just, you know, how can we make the next show even funnier than the last? How can we make the next prank fucking funnier than the last? You know, not that it was all, like, scripted by any means, because a lot of it was just fucking straight off the bat, fucking straight at you.
Certainly all and the that, most fond memories that people have from the show, I think, were those moments that were just natural, organic, in the moment, unscripted.
Oh, definitely, yeah. It was like,
When the crew had gone home, it's just you guys left.
Yeah, you can't script bullshit, I tell you that now, right? I remember, like, the amount of times that we used to fill out the health and safety forms and just post them under the health and safety fucking person's hotel room or fucking room in Cardiff, you know, the House of Doom.
So you actually had crew members staying in that house with you guys, did you?
Yeah, we had crew members. Yeah, there was. Yeah, we all lived together as one big happy family. It was like the Waltons gone fucking wrong.
That's what I've been saying when we've been doing these live Q&As. It was like a fucked up Big Brother season one.
Oh, fuck.
Wasn't it? Before
hell.
Big Brother.
Well, yeah, pretty much, man. Yeah,
the first reality show, you might say.
I hate that fucking term reality. Yeah, but
because of what it's become, but it really was. I've mentioned this a couple of times in podcasts and in the live shows. Jackass, for me, I'm a huge fan of that show.
So
always
am I.
Will be.
So am I.
Without them, obviously, probably MTV wouldn't have given you guys the show, probably.
Oh, definitely
because
not.
They'd seen how successful that format could be. But their format for me seemed a lot more staged, put on, exaggerated.
Absolutely.
With you guys, it was just, here's four mates who are probably going to be getting up to this kind of stuff, even if they didn't have a TV show.
We were doing it already, you know, like, Pritch and Dainton, you know, they established, you know, like, P versus D, myself and Joyce, you know, we had parts there. But then, you know, as the show grew, it wasn't just the Pritchard and Dayton show. It was like, it was a dynamic.
Yeah,
it
like
was
a band.
It was the four of us. We became a fucking band. It was solidified, like, fucking, we're all there. It's all four of us. Obviously, like, Pritch and Dayton, they have their fucking beef, you know, and that's just an ongoing thing. And that will always be until the day they fucking die.
Yeah, but that was just one strand to the format, wasn't
it? Yeah, it was just one strand, but, like, the whole dynamic was made up of all four of us, you know?
Yeah.
Like, Joyce being the most perverse motherfucker.
Which he relished and reveled in, didn't he?
Yeah, like, you know, me being very, very intoxicated and, yeah, I was game on for a lot of stunts, you know?
Well, do you know the thing that I love about you is the one-liners, dude? Like, so many of the show's highlights, I think, were these snippets that you just seemingly came up with on the spot. Johnny Cash snort some ash.
Yeah.
No more nettles for tea, boys.
Yeah, this organic stuff is shit, boys.
You're right, in the convertible. All those, I mean, let's go back a little bit. Were you interested in comedy as a kid? Were you somebody that grew up with a fascination with performers and stand-ups?
Yeah,
there seems to be a bit of that in you.
I always used to watch like Ken Dodd stuff, you know, with my grandpa and stuff. And yeah, maybe like, do you know what, Matt? I've never even thought about it until now. Yeah, but perhaps I had like a bit of an influence on the one-liners. My mother was always very good with one-liners.
Which is that where it came from?
Like I said, I went to a Catholic school and there was a charity called CAFUD. I don't know if you're aware of it. But basically, I had underage sex.
Not the name of that pub we've just seen.
No, not the Craddock.
So where's this money going to the booze?
It's like a missionary type thing.
Right.
Where lots of... where lots of missionaries and stuff go. And I ended up having sex.
Where's this going?
When I was young. No, listen to me now. Not with a Cafford woman. With my girlfriend at the time. And I'd broken my shoulder skateboarding.
Fucking hell, there you go. Like, yeah, that's a gnarly scar. Dave's got one of those right there. It looks very similar.
Yeah. But this one. And so basically, you could tell anyone in these missionaries anything in confidence.
Like confession, yeah.
Like a confession. So Kate ends up, I'm not going to say her surname. She ends up...
Okay, she's listening.
She won't mind anyway. Yeah. Right. Yeah, so I end up... Yeah, we end up having sex. And I don't...
How old are you when you reach virginity?
I'm 13.
I'm 13 too. So that's not too bad.
Yeah.
13. You're sexually active, I think, at that age. A lot of people are.
Yeah.
As long as the other person is 13 as well.
I ended up losing my virginity to that girl. And she told the Cafford people in confidence that she thought she was pregnant.
Right.
And being pregnant in a Catholic school in the early 90s was very, very frowned upon.
Sinful, you might say.
Yes. And as I said earlier, my mother worked in the school. So I ended up getting pulled out of a French lesson.
Wow, mid-lesson.
Yeah. And there's the RE teacher and my mother. And my mother says, have you been having sexual intercourse with you know whom?
Fill in the blank.
Yeah. I said, I don't know what you mean. Well, she's just confessed. So as it turns out now, her parents used to live next door to my grandparents. Her dad comes screaming down in the car to my parents' house. You know, we've been courting for like 6 months.
Courting,
and stuff.
You old gent.
Oh, I know. Yeah. Oh, who said romance is dead? Yeah.
But let me just ask this real quick. Where did you lose your virginity? Was the location?
It was actually in her father's bed.
Oh, so it wasn't in a field or a park.
Yeah, I had a broken shoulder. She gave me 2 pints of Albright Best Bitter, which is quite popular in Wales. Yeah, it's probably only
just
about
to get
three.
You in the mood.
It's only about 3%. Yeah, and we had sex, and it wasn't. We didn't know if we did it properly or not.
It was so experimental.
So anyway, so her dad comes flying down to my dad's house. So my dad goes toe to him, going, don't you fucking have a go at my son, this, that, the other. And my grandpa, like, don't you have a go at my fucking grandson. So he, like, her dad went, like, look, I'm taking her out of school. I'm putting her to private school. But we carried on after she went to private school. Yeah. But
like that.
Yes. Yeah.
You can't stop love.
There was one time that I was in a local boozer called the Baglebrook, and I could see this chap struggling with a massive load, like tray of drinks. And I held the door open and he actually said, thank you. And that was her dad.
That's him.
And I was thinking, ooh, that probably cost you a fucking good few grand, mate.
Yeah. Did you have any brothers or sisters growing up, or do you have?
Yeah, I do. I have. I'm the eldest of three brothers.
Three boys.
Yeah, I have a middle brother who's a very successful legal executive.
There you go.
I am. My youngest brother actually works in the Talbot Steelworks as an electrician. Yeah.
So they're both still around here.
Yeah, Simon lives in Cardiff. Chris lives in Talbot. He actually lives in the family house now, after mum and dad passed away. Yeah, so but like we're extremely close. Yeah, you know, as close as brothers can be. You know, they're both married with kids and stuff. So I'm still living the black sheep legacy, really. You know.
When does skateboarding come into your life?
I started skateboarding either 11 or 12. And just really, really, really enjoyed it. And by the time I was 13, I was going to Cardiff. And that's where I got introduced to, like, Pritchard. Pritchard was a heavy hitter. And it was.
Was he the first of the other three that you met?
He was the first of the other three, yeah. And, yeah, to be honest, I was in awe. I was starstruck, you know, because he was in the magazines and stuff. But he came skating down the hill from a Cardiff train station at the time on his knees, and he pointed at me, and there was a professional skateboarder who was a midget in California called Pancho Mola. And that fucking nickname has stuck with me to this fucking day, right? You know, wherever I go in the UK, you know, like, oh, it's Pancho, Pancho, Pancho. It's like, only my mother used to call me Mike. Well, my girlfriend, on-off girlfriend. You know, if she's really cross, she'd call me Michael. My mates, like, from PT, they call me Locke, because that's my surname. Locke.
And literally everybody else.
Yeah, but a lot of them, Pancho, and yeah, they even try to wind me up, some of them, by calling me Pancho, because when you're with, like, people you were in school with, who were oblivious to it, it's like, come on, man, you know me fucking before this. And my daughters, when they really want to piss me off, they call me Patio.
Does it bother you being called that? Or are you fully at peace?
What, Patio or Pancho?
Pancho.
No, like...
You embrace it.
Well, it's been 27 years now, so yeah, I've embraced it, yeah. I have no problem with it at all.
The P versus D skate tape, which is obviously then what leads on to Dirty Sanchez.
Yeah.
You have a premiere for that, don't you guys in Wales? And it's quite the event, and I'm led to believe that that was kind of the night that, I guess, Pancho, as everybody else knows him, was born, perhaps.
Because your segment, you hadn't really seen in
the film until the premiere, right?
No, but I was quite instrumental on the UK's, well, not instrumental, that's a very big headed, but I'd had coverage in Rad Skateboard magazine when I was 14.
That would have been as Mike Locke, though, right?
No, Mike Pancho Locke.
Was it? Oh, okay.
And then I added, like, numerous photos, and it was Pancho. So
right.
That wasn't actually the first time that the public were really made aware of the Pancho. Obviously, it amplified it.
Yeah.
But, it wasn't the first time. Like, within the UK skate scene, I was always known as Pancho.
So from the moment Pritchard spotted you and called you that, that was it?
That just pretty much stuck then and there? Yep, that's correct.
Love it.
And just leading on, Pancho Mola
has
now gone on to become a porn star.
Has he really?
So then me, I don't think I'm really cut out for that, but never say never.
What's your memory of the House of Doom? Let's go in on that one. Season one, you're obviously thrown into this house. No experience whatsoever with television and the film crew and how to make a show, but you're all, I guess, given
the
keys to the kingdom.
Yeah, in one word, debauchery.
Straight up
debauchery. There was no holding back, you know. You were given all these utensils and you could just mess around, and there was party tokens, you there and everywhere. I remember myself and Pritch staying awake all night, drinking slabs of Budweiser and just teeing off with a golf club against the wall. And
smashing the bottles in the house.
Yeah. Like, in hindsight, it was completely idiotic and stupid. But you know what?
You're young kids.
When you have no responsibility, when you're kids, you don't give a fuck, man.
Of course not.
You just want to go and fuck shit up.
Well,
that's exactly what we did.
You're being employed to do that.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. But there's a funny story, and I'm not sure if the other guys touched on it, but we had a health and safety guy called Begbie, and yep. I believe they did, because I have heard the podcast, but they were some time ago. Yeah, and Begbie, like, we turned up the BMX, he was bringing down God knows what from Scotland, and he was up to no good. And
he didn't last long, I'm led to believe.
No. Becky Stanifall through, like, I love Becky.
She's the director.
Shout out to Becky, you know, like, yeah, she's the director. She's the pioneer. She was the driving force behind a lot of it.
Did she have a work cut out keeping you four in line?
Oh, fuck. Do you know what? At times, she would really embrace it. But then at other times, she's like, guys, you've really got to wind your neck in. And I sounded like Jim Mickey then, but
yeah, yeah, you did.
Beck was more fucking manly than Jim Mickey. not in a bad way, Beck. You're beautiful, and I love you in every sense.
Did anything from the filming of season one not make the show that stands out? Either too hot for TV or just there wasn't a place for it within the show? Are there any skits or moments that you remember being filmed that didn't end up in the first season?
There's nothing in particular on the first season, but there is certainly one on the second season.
Go on then, let's go to season two. Well, first of all, before we get to that, season one airs. Tell me about that fame hurricane that follows it and what it was like for you guys adjusting to that.
It was just absolutely, you know, you go...
debauchery times two.
Well, yeah, it's just like everybody wants you in their bars, you know, females love you, you know. Not that it was ever a problem in the past, but it certainly did escalate things. And yeah, it was just like everybody wanted you at their party, and you know, you had a lot of money, you could do pretty much what you wanted, and there was fucking no holds barred, really. It was, you know, walking down the street and everybody knows your name
overnight, pretty much,
just
as well,
overnight,
right?
just like that. And yeah, that took a lot of adapting to.
Were all four of you on the same page with it? Did all four of you go into it together as one united group?
I'd say the person who probably was most confident due to his skateboard talents was Matthew Pritchard. Because he'd been such, you know, been on that stature within skateboarding and stuff, you know.
Which is ironic because he kind of comes across as the most shy in some of those early scenes in season one. And he's spoken to me about it. You know, when he's in the kitchen, he said he was so nervous about being on film in some of those early scenes. Whereas you in particular, and Joyce in particular, seem really comfortable with being on camera.
Well, do you know what, Matt? That's where looks can be deceiving.
Right. It was all front, was it? You were putting on a brave face.
Well, yeah, my ass was twitching and everything. You know, it was definitely a big shock to the system. You know, and like my family, like they found it really weird when people started knocking the family fucking door.
That happened, did it?
Yeah. Because my parents were on series one and two, and yeah, there's a funny story, and this I'll cut to this just really quick. My dad used to work in the steelworks as well. My dad goes into work on a Monday morning, and they're like, "Oh, Di, we saw you on TV last night." He went, "Oh, not my bloody son show." And when I go, "Oh no, Sir Trevor MacDonald." And he went, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, the happy slapping craze." So they tried pinning that on myself and my dad. And dad was just mortified. Yeah. As much as he liked a good laugh, he was like, "Bloody hell, Michael, that's it. I'm pulling back that disclaimer. They can fuck right off. I'm not fucking being fucking accused of fucking headline fucking tabloid news, no."
Well, they always want someone to blame, don't they?
Yes, they always want someone to blame, yeah.
And I guess you guys were prime material.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. And it was just a thing that started off, you know, it's like something that people do on a rugby or football tour. It's like, and that's the way that the first series of Sanchez, the way that I tried to relay it, it's like it was a constant rugby or football fucking tour. But you've got the means to do pretty much what the fuck you want.
When you were getting stitched up, you know, you'd obviously have a few drinks, fall asleep, wake up, something would have happened to you. Were there any moments where you thought, "I've really had enough of this happening"? Or did you take it in good jest to begin?
Yeah, and like there was obviously times, you know, where I flip out when your eyebrows are gone and stuff. I think just human nature and stuff. But also there were times when I fucked the other boys up. But like, TV can make you look, you know, one way or stuff. You know, there was other stuff, you know, that should have made fucking footage, but it didn't, you know? And that's, yeah, going back to what you were saying, you know, perhaps some of that stuff, you know, I wish that had gone in, you know?
What you about
not,
season
not,
two?
Not as like a Pancho's Revenge thing.
But... Yeah, Pancho's Revenge.
God, perhaps Pancho's Revenge coming soon.
What was the
midlife crisis?
What was the scene in season two which got left out then?
Right. Well, it was actually my 25th birthday, and we were staying with cowboys
in Arizona,
in New Gales, Arizona, and on my 25th birthday. Jimbo, his name was.
That's Jim Hickey, the director, isn't
it? No. This was like the cattle, like the rancher, right?
Yeah.
But he used to have these rancheros, and there was one called Ramos. And who's the guy off Machete?
Danny Trejo?
Yes.
Yeah.
He reminded me of Danny Trejo. Yeah?
Right. What, because he looked like a gnarly, hardened criminal?
Real gnarly, burly, sketchy... Mexican, right? And he was, and Jimbo was like, "Look, we're gonna go across now for your birthday, like that." So we go into New Gales, Mexico, and we're walking down the high street, and because the show was so big in Latin America, it's like, "Pancho, Dainton, Pritchard, Joycey, come drink tequila, tacos." Yo, you want women? We got women. We got everything. It was just like something, because like it hadn't even got through to the States at the time, and it just went. It just that was just like such a culture shock. Then going in there, it was my 25th birthday, and yeah, we ended up in a strip joint and having some great fun, and yeah, you know, like good coffee. Yeah, it was great. It was great. It was good fun. But we end up then coming back over the border. Not even before that, no, right? Well, Ramos, he was a bit naughty. But we end up coming back over the border, like, all right? And we're driving along. Now, I'm in the boot, and it's just bouncing, going along like these dirt tracks, getting back to the ranch, yeah? We get back there now, and there's a big fire going. We crack open some beers and stuff. And the next thing you know, Jimbo, he comes along, and he's got this big iron fucking casket, like that, right? And he's like, "You've been branding my cattle all week. Well, now it's time for you boys to get branded too." And I was like, holy fuck. He's like, "Man, shut up first. It's your 25th birthday." So I was like, fuck that. Pritch is like, "Fuck this, man. I'm going to do it. I'm going to fucking do it. I'm going to nail it. Like, all right. So Pritch gets it like done on his thigh.
What are you getting done? What's the actual?
We're getting branded.
Yeah. But what are you getting branded on?
We're getting branded DS. So Pritch gets it done. He's like, "Oh, Pancho, it's not too bad."
Just to set the scene now, Pancho's about to reveal the scar from the brand. Yeah, there you go. What we can see is an outline of where the hair used to be.
Yeah, like nothing will grow back there anymore.
How much did that hurt on a scale of 1 to 10?
On a scale of 1 to 10, fucking hardly anything at the
really?
Time, because it kills all the nerve endings. Yeah,
it's the aftermath.
So then Joyce decides to have it on his belly. You know, I couldn't think of anything worse. So he's just like this gibbering wreck going away, and he's just got little bits. The other member of the clan locked himself away in the car.
Lee Dainton.
Yeah. Dainton locked himself away. But the worst...
And he had a big strop, didn't he? He's spoken about this. He said that's one of the times that there was a bit of a fallout, because he was like, I'm not doing it. And didn't he set fire to someone's tent afterwards?
No, he was definitely pissed. I forget, man. And like, I don't know, it was my 25th birthday. I was fucked up. I can't remember the aftermath. What I do remember is... having a nice, I bought some Tommy Hilfiger shorts, like on the cheap out in America, as you do, isn't it? In the ball. And they were like a beige colour. And like when we were flying back, I was like, "Boys, your brand's like really," and this is where the pain comes in now. It's the upkeep, the weeping, the sobbing.
Weeping is the word, yeah.
Yeah. Because it's, you know, it's a first degree fucking burn. Yeah.
Yep.
So anyway, we get back to the UK. The shoot date is not until for a fortnight in the Marines. But Jim, fucking clever hickey, decides to pull it forward. So it's only 4 days, right? So, like, none of us have been to the hospital because I believe branding is illegal in the UK.
Right.
I think it is. Yeah.
Because it's mutilation.
Yes, yeah. It is fucking mutilation. Yeah, absolutely. Right, yeah. But, yeah, so we end up in Exmouth and we do the first day's training. It's the one where I almost fucking drowned.
Yeah. Which people thought was fake, didn't they? Because that last episode.
Oh, holy fuck.
Let's set the record straight.
I had the full kit on. I thought, I'm a pretty strong swimmer, but I underestimated coming off the board, like the power to kick up off the bed of the floor of the pool. So I literally only had tippy toes. Well, I have to stay calm. You can do this, Mike. You're a strong swimmer. Just stay calm. Next thing you know, panic sets in. One comes in to try and see me. You can do it. Another one, I think it was 3 or 4 in the end to get me out. So anyway, like we continue with the rest of the day and it's like, fuck drinking the night before this. Fucking, let's go and get them, see these brands. Let's go and get them sorted. So we turn up at Exmouth, like it's a tiny little hospital, A&E.
All three of you that have been branded
Pritch
together.
Pritch goes up first. He goes, what's the matter? He's like, I've got a burn on my leg. Goes in and the nurses were kind of laughing because I was retarded.
They knew who you were as well, presumably.
Well, yeah. I think he did have a photo with them. Yeah. But, yeah, so I go up next. I could just hear him laughing. And then with Joycey, he goes up and he's just got this like miss and match on his belly, like, you know, like burns and stuff. And it's, yeah. So, yeah, they put like this dressing on, which really helped and give us some like good medical advice. And yeah, the Marines, they helped a lot. But yeah, the Marines, they're a crazy fucking bunch themselves.
How did you find the shooting of season 2? Did you find that there was pressure on you guys to replicate the success of season 1? And did you feel like some of it was perhaps a little bit scripted? And
I thought it was definitely more structured because, you know, like it was Jobs for the Boyos. But
the best theme song ever, by the way. I love the working on the site from morning to night. So good, isn't it?
Yeah,
that's living all right.
Yeah, our feed is in bed. Yeah, I was definitely brought up around that. That was one of my dad's favorites. My mum never used to really like me watching it. But
it was the perfect fit, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It was great. Yeah, but yeah, the second series, like ultimately it had to be more structured in order to get a budget. And then, you know, but just with the same series, you know, no matter what stuff was put on paper or this'll work, 80% of it was absolute crap, you know. It was just the stuff that was just off the cuff, raw, straight to the point. And I think that's what set us apart from Jackass, because
it was real.
Yeah, it was real. It was done on a fucking shoestring budget. There was no fucking mass fucking huge budget, you know, to pull things off. You know, we struggled to get fucking legal insurance, you know, and that's what prolonged, you know, the first and the second series. You know, there was multiple factors, and sometimes we didn't help ourselves, I'll be honest.
Yeah. Well, because you're not prepared for that, are you? You're not trained or schooled in that.
No, absolutely not.
You're like, you've hired us to be this. This is all we know.
Yeah, and it was just like being on a skateboard, rugby, football tour.
Yeah, constantly.
Constant, yeah.
Season 3, dude, there's a scene...
I've got a question for you. Quickly.
Fire away. Go on.
Right, well, you've ask lived life on a tour bus.
I certainly have.
Yeah, they're not as luxurious as people think they are they?
Well, for me, I would sooner stay in a hotel and get trains on my own. And that's what I actually did around Europe on this Steel Panther tour, because... First of all, there's no privacy. So if you want to link up with girls, you can't really do that. You're in a bunk bed that's the size of a coffin. So it's a no-go. And also, you can't shower on them. You can't poo on them. It's not what you would call comfortable living, no. And it's not traveling. I mean, the great thing is you can wake up, if you're on a busy scheduled tour, you can wake up at the venue, you're there, you can then just go into the venue, shower, freshen up. It's a little bit easier on the body and mind than... Go on, Pancho, let's have a beer. If you've got one, I'm going to break my detox. 18 days clean, 18 minutes with Pancho here. Is this the last one?
Is this my fault?
Is this the last one?
No, don't worry. We've got someone to go and get some more.
Okay. Well, you can have half of this anyway. You got a glass?
Fucking no. What? You don't want much tea. Come down here, you English.
You English. Racist. So how come you asked me that? About the tour bus.
Because.
That was obviously season 3 for you guys, was on the bus around Europe.
Yeah, because the reason I posed that question, Matt, is because... As you know, it's not all what people make it out to be. You think, oh, yeah, we've really made it. We've got this luxurious tour bus, and this is fantastic.
When they must be rolling in cash. Yeah.
The reality is you get a shower once a week. You got no privacy.
Well, not only that, with you guys, right, you're on top of each other.
Yeah,
people
exactly,
are pranking each other.
Exactly.
The minute you fall asleep, you're getting fucked with.
That's where cracks start to form.
Yeah, was it really? It's the classic, again, band story, isn't it? Is you're out on the road, you can't get away from each other, no escape.
Yeah.
And it's like in the house, but intensified.
Oh, yeah, but it's magnified so much. Yeah. You know, like in a house, you can just get out of the street and fuck off home to your own fucking yard.
Yeah.
Or hotel, whatever. When you're on that bus.
Cheers, brother.
Cheers, mate.
There's no escape.
There is no escape. You know, you're in the middle of fucking Norway. You can't just go get me the fuck off this bus. You know, it's fucking minus God knows wherever. You know, and yeah, I was just trying to explain to the audience that like tour life is not all the people think it is. You know, especially on a tour bus.
It's the reason a lot of bands break up.
Yeah, don't get me wrong. I love experiencing different cultures. I love different countries, meeting new people. You know, just embracing all that, but. When you're on in each other's pockets 24/7, fucking 7 days a week for fucking 3 months, it becomes
hell.
Hell on earth, pretty much.
You throw booze and drugs in the mix. Yeah. You throw all the pranks that you're doing on each other.
Yeah, exactly, because you know, it even got to the point when we were in Italy and we actually had our own hotel rooms. That they'd gone in and said, oh, Mike Locke, I've lost my card, gone into my room and fucking shaved fucking half my hair off. You know, and that's, you know, so you can imagine what it's like when you're on a tour bus, you know, when you just got a little curtain, you know, and you're well intoxicated, you know, how were you meant to relax?
Weren't you all left?
That is called being on pins.
Torturous, isn't it?
It's torture. Yeah, it's a form of torture, yeah.
Weren't you all left on the motorway in one of the countries? Didn't the bus driver just say, right, get off,
yes.
I'm off? And that was the first time your tour manager had seen that happen.
That was actually a calculated plan.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, it's like, yeah, because of those fractures and we just wanted some creature comforts. You know, not throwing the toys out the pram, but like enough was enough. And to be honest, The bus driver, he's a wanker anyway. So, yeah, we were going down the motorway and some pepper spray managed to... somehow, some way, just make his way down into the driver's cockpit. And he pulled over and he said, I've been on tour with anthrax. I've been to this, that, the other. But he said, never, ever have I ever met a bunch of fuck-ups like you.
Got to be proud with that.
Fuck yeah, anthrax, man. Yeah.
So there's a scene in, I don't know whether it made the show or not, but basically Pritch goes MIA. I think because he's partied out, he's got an anxiety attack.
Yeah, I believe it's in Milan.
Milan. And the usual stunt, and the way it usually goes down, is Stellar Enema.
Yeah.
And he's the one who does it, and then he shits the beer on Joycey's face, right? But then he's gone, so you have to assume Pritch's role and do the Stellar Enema for him. Tell us about that. Was that in the show, or did it not make the cut? I don't think it made the cut.
I don't think it actually made the cut.
But tell us about the story.
Yeah, there's only two. I don't mind the odd little rope finger off the missus now and again. But like for me, it's personally, It's you know, it's a one-way shoot.
We should say as well at this point, the Stella Enema, for those who don't know, is you put a tube up your bumhole and attempt to drink beer through your ass. So you get it up inside there.
Yes.
And then you shower it all out. Well, and Joycey would put his face in front of the butt when he with goggles on and receive the load.
Yeah.
Which is fucking disgusting.
It is disgusting.
He told the story of why he started doing the face as well, because he was drinking it initially, but then the doctor said, you're getting all this bacteria in your throat.
It was vile. It got to the point with them lot that they used to do pre-gig enemas. we actually fucked up a massive tour, like with Luminar Leisure. I don't know if you know about this.
No.
Yeah, because of the mess of the enema.
I can imagine the mess is quite something.
Yeah, well, with me, I didn't. Well, yeah, it did.
It's not look, your thing, right?
But, it's not. It's
but
not Pritch my bag.
Pritch is gone, and somebody's got to do it. Like, so look, come up, you're the man for the job.
Yeah. Well, look, you just got to step up to the table now and again and do things. We all have to do things in life we don't like to do.
So that was one of those. What happened? Cocktail bar in Milan.
It was a cocktail. It was a high polloi thing. It was fucking pretty, like, fashion end. You know, like, high-end fashion.
Not the sort of place that Dirty Sanchez should be performing live.
Oh, yeah, totally wrong quote.
But therein lies the joke, obviously.
No. They kind of frowned upon it. Yeah,
of course it
didn't particularly go too well. Like, do you know what? I'm really struggling to remember this.
Well, do you want me to recount it for you and then you can take over? Right. So you put the tube up your ass is what I hear.
No, fucking hell, I know that shit. I know that shit, yeah, but like...
But you put it so far up.
No, I know.
But you drink the beer and it goes right up inside your stomach. So you go to spray Joycey with the beer and...
Yeah, and then...
Just straight up shit comes out,
a
right?
A lollipop.
All over his face.
All over his face.
And then there's just a slow clap. In the bar,
yeah,
as people
Joyce,
are leaving and shaking their heads.
Joyce fucking deserved that. Anyway.
So you and Joyce used to share rooms a lot when the four of you were on the road.
I guess
Pritch and Dainton would share, and you and Joyce would share. Tell me about sharing a room with Joycey and your friendship with him, first of all, over the years. And
I'm very...
You must have spent a lot of time together.
I'm fond of all the lads, but me and Joyce. Yeah, he was great, man. You know, like I was an usher in his wedding, and believe it or not, he's married. Yeah, but I'm very fond of Dan. He's always up for a good laugh. Like his mother, his family. You know, people portray him to be this way, and he is Mr. Shock Value. He was at least. Yeah. But there's no taboo like to. Oh, there weren't any taboo that would hold him back. But
that was his unique magic, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. And you know what? He'd always make me smile, apart from when like he'd wake up and go, "You've kept me awake all night snoring." But then like some of the comedy pranks he'd come up with, he'd be like, "Oh, let's make this into two single rooms." And he'd like just have safety pins and put like a bed sheet in, and then he'd be like, what's it called when you can see someone when you're imitating, like through what's the word for
what, like shadow puppets?
Look at my shadow wank, look at my shadow wank. Do you know what? It was always like, yeah,
he kept you entertained on the road,
just keep me entertained, and you know, like even. No matter what shit was going on, he was, like, sometimes he can be a moody bastard, like, just like us all, but...
Well, he's spiky, isn't he? And he's very upfront with his feelings. He doesn't beat around the bush.
Oh, no, he doesn't beat around the bush. No. No, but I think he'll also say that I'm probably one of the nicest people he'll ever meet. You know, he's...
A good egg, might say.
A good egg, yeah. Which was spawned from... For my own mouth, by the way. Yeah. Along with fucking Montenegro and fucking God knows what else. Yeah. Going back to the one-liners, maybe. Yeah.
Let's discuss Pritchard and your friendship with him.
Pritchard, absolute inspiration. Even when I first met him back in the early 90s.
You went on a trip together to Germany, right? Where you had to pose as his son to get in.
That's right, yeah. But I, like, Pritchard had, Pritchard was only like 22, 23. I was 15. Right, hang on. If I'm, he would have been 20 when he's 6 years older than me. Yeah. So, yeah, we get to all these big competitions. Matthews, he's been invited by the American sponsor, Deanne, at the time. And, I blagged it in as his son on numerous occasions. And then we docked my fucking passport to go out tonight.
So it would say Matthew Pritchard and then Michael Pritchard as his little son. I'm sure people want to know this as well. Are you still Michael Pritchard? Are you still married?
No,
are you still legally bonded?
No.
That's over, is it?
Oh, it's well and truly
You're
over.
You're fully separated.
He was crap. I was fantastic.
So the wedlock has been broken.
Oh, yes, indeed. Indeed. Yeah, I believe Matthew's engaged to get to be married. And Pritch just one fucking crazy motherfucker, man. Crazy on a skateboard. Even crazier in the party. Now he's taking it on to like, I'm so, so proud of him. So, so proud of him. In fact.
Here we go, right here.
There we go.
His brand new vegan cookbook.
We've got the cookbook right
available
here.
Now on all good bookstops.
I believe in Amazon is £8 at this
there we go.
Time.
I didn't get one. Gutted.
Did you not?
No.
Oh, well, let's not fall out of this, right? Do you want me to doctor the name for you?
I'll have a little look through it, though, before we wrap up. Because I haven't actually seen any of the recipes
absolutely.
Yet.
Absolutely. But, more to the point, you know, like, I know his whole family. All of them are great people. And I think, you know, with the triathlon things and stuff that the Matthew and his brother have achieved, I think it's far, you know, it's fucking Batman shit. It's insane.
He is a bit of a superhero, isn't he?
Well, I remember when he came back from Milan after having that big anxiety attack, he went to the pooper and he had a health check and the doctor went, oh yeah, you're totally fine. And his exact words were, well, does that mean I'm Batman? Well, that's Pritch, you know,
he's a man of extremes.
He's a man of extremes. And you know what? I'm very proud of what he's done in business and stuff. And yeah, good on him. Yeah, he's fantastic. Proper good egg. Or vegan egg.
Yeah. Veg. And what about you and Dane? What's that friendship? What's the dynamic there? What's the nature of that relationship?
Me and Dane have always had a love and hate relationship, really. But I'd say there's a lot more love than hate. He was kind enough for, like, I had my first ever professional skateboard, like, out on Kill City through Dayton. I don't know, man. Sometimes we collided, and I think a lot of that was to do with, like, me and Pritch going off and doing stuff with Channel 4 and BBC 3. The paymen thing on Channel 4. But you know what? He's like irrelevant to that shit. He's like, just like all of them, he's like a brother to me, man. You know, and I wouldn't, you know, like they went, the boys went on and did other stuff, you know, and I'm stoked for that. I'm glad he's doing really well with his filming and whatnot.
I think with every scenario like yours, you hit the nail on the head there with the brotherly reference, because what you guys went through from youth to adulthood in the fucking light of the public eye with like, the extreme boom. Experiences, highs, lows, everything in between. It's going to bond the four of you in a way that's so unique. And unless you've been through something vaguely similar, it's hard to really relate.
But,
isn't it?
Matt, my mother, right. And this is the way I relate to it. And my mother is a very wise lady. Right, the boys all like Susie Locke. We used to have a Locke joke. Susie Locke loves cock, blah, blah, blah. But she used to come up with the one-liners, and that's what I forgot to say. Do you know, after the Catford thing, she said, Mike, keep your rocket in your pocket.
Straight
but,
away,
but anyway,
didn't miss a beat.
Anyway, going back to Susie's wiser side now, right? She went and got to me. She said, Mike, when you grow up, she said, you love your children in different ways. But that doesn't mean that you love them any less or any more. It's just you love people in different ways. And I think that's definitely transpired. You know, like Not just with that, with friendships. You know, with friends, do you know what I mean?
Each relationship is unique, isn't it?
Because, you know, otherwise, you know, we'd all just be this fucking monotone nation. And do you know what? If you haven't got an opinion, to be honest, I don't really want to fucking know you, whether I agree or not. You know,
stand for something or you'll fall for anything.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, yeah. I like that one. It's good, isn't it?
It's not mine. I can't remember who coined that, but that sums it up, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Have passion.
Yeah. But like when I had my own children, I realised that. And then spending so much time with the lads, you know, it's like you love them. You love them in different ways. You don't love them anywhere, you know, more or less.
Just different.
Yeah. They're just all different. Fucking cunts.
Cunts you love to hate and love to love.
Yes, exactly.
From your point of view, Panch, how did things come to an end? Obviously, we need to talk a little bit about the movie as well, but we won't go too much into the movie and we'll say why at the end of this. But jumping ahead past the movie, and I guess MTV pull back, don't they? And they're not really going to give you any more backing to film. They're not going to allow you to use the name. So the four of you go on the roads and start touring and doing live shows.
We start touring and then you realise that, you know, like once you split things four ways, it becomes difficult. And then certain people's greed gets in the way and... You know, and then things meander, you know, and then Pritch and Dink went into their stuff. Me and Joyce went into our stuff. And, you know, things really, yeah, they needed to go that way, to be honest.
When did the, you know, you said the cracks started to form in season three. When did the cracks really blow open? Was it when you were doing those tours after the film?
It was the cracks really said, they really came to light. After the film was done.
And you're on the road. And that's all you're doing.
Yeah, on the road, you know, traveling all over the fucking world. And yeah, that's...
I guess if you're not making a TV show as well, those roles aren't as clearly defined.
No, at least when you've got a show format to work within, it's like, well, that's your thing.
This is my thing.
And the boys went on to do stuff, you know, which I think is great. You know, they went and did like the Sanchez Got High stuff. But I think there was always like that element between me and Dink. And it's not the case now, but like at that moment in time, where, like in the heat, there was probably animosity there for just purely due to that factor.
Because you and Pritchard done Pain Men and him and Pritchard done Get High.
And then... You know,
we'd breaking up the group.
Yeah, we did like a BBC Three thing. Me and Pritch was like a pilot with Paddy McGuinness and stuff. I don't know, like a lot. There's a lot of like mitigating, contributing factors, but you know, at the end of the day, all good things must, you know,
come to an end.
Unfortunately, definitely be put on ice.
Yes,
you know? I'm going to be the first to admit, I think sometimes my drinking piss people off. You know, because, you know, I was going, and I've certainly sorted myself out. You know, and I've held down reputable jobs and stuff still. You know, still stuff that's really close to my heart. But, you know, I think, yeah. And it's still something I need to work on. You know, there's certain things. It's like, if something bad happens, I drink in an attempt to forget it.
Yeah, yeah, I can relate
to that.
Something
good happens.
You drink to celebrate.
If nothing's happening,
you drink to pass the time. Yeah.
Yeah.
I hear you.
And you know that, isn't it?
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you think that the end of Sanchez hit you in a way that you didn't quite know at the time, in an emotional way? Do you think it left certain unresolved issues, or?
I think yeah. I'm.
Or were you already?
No, fairly out of hand
with the booze at that point, anyway.
No. I was prepared for it, to be honest.
Yeah,
I
saw it coming.
For it, yeah. I was more because like me and Joycey were going out and fucking doing. We're doing like 4 or 5 gigs a month. You know, like just, but then like you realize, you know, things have to evolve and stuff.
Yeah.
And this is what I'm really excited about, you know, is, you know, I'm like working on a really cool venture now, not just with the clothing, but, you know, the Pancho tacos and stuff. You know, that's really starting to flourish now. You know, it's taken long enough, but if it's going to be done, it's got to be right.
Yeah.
And it's not jumping on the bandwagon of Pritch, because I'm not even a vegan.
Well, and also, you clearly love to cook, and like Pritchard, like Dayton, like Joycey, you're a brand within yourself as well as in within that Dirty Sanchez format. Dayton is the brand of videography, cinematography, editing. That's his thing.
That's what he's doing. He kills it at that.
Pritchard has his thing now, the Iron Man kind of, you know, health conscious thing. And, you know, you have the Good Time Pancho brand, which you can obviously use. Taco is the perfect party food.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know,
it would be a shame to not capitalize on that. Excuse the term.
No, it's just a case of...
And Joycey obviously is doing the video stuff as well.
Yeah,
Joycey has his own
Joycey
Division unit.
Yeah. Yeah, that's amazing. But I just feel that, you know what? Like, cooking comes from my heart, and there's something...
Well, it's about bringing people together, isn't
it? Yeah, exactly.
That's what tacos
are so perfect
for.
And do you know what? They're like, deep down, if people really, really know me, they'll know I'm a family man. You know, I love my friends. You know, yeah, I can be wild. We can all be wild.
Well, we're sat here right now. This is your friend's house that he's kindly let us use to do this chat. You took me by his shop earlier. He gave me a T-shirt. Never met the guy. Yeah. You can see, and I've noticed this certainly with Pritch and Dayton, particularly Dayton, actually, when I've been to see him in Cumbran, is he's, like you, I think, a community guy. He's a community guy. He's a family guy. And when you're walking around with him in Cumbran, like I've just seen today with you in Port Talbot, you know everyone. You know, home's where the heart is.
Yeah.
And you've got good, honest, old-fashioned values.
Yes. Yeah.
Beneath the craziness.
Yeah. Like amongst all the craziness and stuff, I know what's important to me in my life.
Yeah.
And yeah, you know, you know what? Like, deep down, I would love to be able just to celebrate and enjoy, you know, taking this thing to the festivals and stuff. You know, don't get me wrong, I still love the odd party.
Well, the struggle with partying, and I'm right there with you, is toeing the line, isn't it?
Well,
and having the right balance.
It's a fine line.
It is, isn't it? Because you can have that one extra shot that tips you over the edge.
Yes, that's true.
And obviously, when you're touring, I've learned the hard way, and now I know when I'm on tour, I'll only have a couple of beers before the show.
Yeah.
I'll know if I have a show the next day. I'll try and not get too out of hand. The story I told you earlier.
Yeah,
that was an exception because I played this, you know, Bataclan venue, and that's quite a significant night.
No,
but
I've
learned
definitely.
That it's all about just reeling it in, isn't it?
Reeling it in, and it's something I'm still working on, but it's super.
And you've obviously had a lot going on in your life as well over the last couple of years.
Yeah. I like, you know, like the death of my mum, especially when she went, that was really tough. Let's not get all morbid on this, but it happens to us all, but she's an absolute legend, and we're going to drink to her in the sky right now.
And she's clearly raised a very honourable man in you.
I don't know, some might say different.
I'm sure they would, mate. I'm sure they would. But actions, for me, aren't as important as character and values. Because you can, you know, make mistakes and do dumb shit, but it's who you are deep down as a person.
It defines
who you are.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. It does define
and she's clearly
me.
A legend, isn't she?
Oh, she's a legend.
Keep your rocket in your pocket.
Yeah, legends never die. Susie Locke, keep your rocket in your pocket. Yeah, that was her comeback.
So, mate, let's talk about this idea which has recently come to fruition. And for me, the last couple of years for me have been about trying to bring together you four guys. That's been my secret mission. And finally, you're the final piece of the puzzle here now, the fourth OG cast member to appear on the podcast. And I've been chatting to the other three guys over the last couple of days, and we've secured a venue in Cardiff.
Whoa.
On December the 12th. So for everybody listening, we have hired out the Tram Shed in Cardiff, and we are going to be screening Dirty Sanchez, the movie. And then following on from the film, there's going to be a live Q&A hosted by myself with Pritchard, Dayton, Joycey, and Pancho on stage together, the four of them for the first time in over a decade.
Look out! I can't wait. Yeah, it's gonna be slightly emotional, I reckon.
I hope so. I hope it's therapeutic for all parties.
Yeah,
and entertaining for everybody who comes.
Yeah. Well, I just hope everyone buys tickets and comes along, because this is the real shit.
Well, one of the last times I think you and Pritch were on stage together, you had an on-stage fight, didn't you? Down in Australia.
Yeah, quite possibly. Quite possibly. I don't know. I'm not even lying. I just I honestly don't know.
Anything could happen.
Yes, anything could happen.
I'm sure there won't be any fisticuffs, though.
No, they won't. No, there's too much love in the air.
I mean, what a wild ride, dude. And it's clearly defined, you know, all four of your lives, for better and worse.
Yes, absolutely.
Like, imagine how different all of your stories would have been had that show never gone to MTV. And
yeah.
It's unfathomable, isn't it, to think about the different courses in which all of your lives
It's absolutely insane to think, you know, where we would have meandered off to. And do you know what? If it wasn't for the love of skateboarding, we'd never have drawn us all together.
Well, that's it. That's where it all began, right?
Which is where it all began. And, like, you know, we're all going off and doing our own stuff now, but like, that bond will never break. And yeah. Yeah. The 12th of December will be a defining moment. Now. Yeah.
I can't fucking wait, dude.
I can't fucking wait. Either. What month are we at now?
Oh, we're way off. We're
A little way off. Yeah.
Pancho, this has been a pleasure and a delight. I hope it's been all right for you.
It's great. I'm just can't wait to go for a week.
raise your glass. Cheers, mate.
Thank you, man.
And here's to completing the set. Here's to the tram shed on the 12th.
Tram
and here's
shed
to
on the
Dirty
12th.
Sanchez.
Cheers, mate.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore. Bells will ring, ting-a-ling-a-ling, ting-a-ling-a-ling, and you'll sing Vita Bella. Hearts will play tippy-tippy-tay, tippy-tippy-tay, like a guitar and a lyre.